All right. Well, we are right on time. It is the lunching hour. So to our guests in the room, I hope you have a chance to go back. Looks like there's a couple left. We do get paid by how few sandwiches there are left over. So if you're trying to be modest, there's really no reward in it for us. So please have a bite to eat. I'd like to say good afternoon and welcome to our briefing today, the Mississippi River. Today marks the first installment in our new briefing series about resilient and healthy rivers. And I'd like to thank Senator Tammy Baldwin and her staff for help with the room today. I'm Dan Brissett. I'm the president of the Environmental and Energy Study Institute. And we are celebrating, we're celebrating 40 years of advancing climate change solutions through congressional education. EESI was founded, and there's some chairs up here in the front. As long as you don't sit where that phone is, we'll be okay, because that's my chair. I like to sit there so I can watch their presentations. I can't see it from up here. We were founded by a bipartisan group of members of Congress, and since 1984, we have worked to provide science-based information about environmental, energy, and climate change topics to policymakers and the public. What does our policymaker education look like? Well, it looks like this. There aren't always sandwiches, but we do a lot of briefings. We do our best to ensure that our resources are timely, relevant, accessible, and practical. We put a lot of thought so that they're ready before congressional staff even know they need them. We do briefings of 24 or so per year. This will actually be our last in-person briefing of the year, but we have a few more coming up in October around the Conference of Parties, the UNFCCC negotiations, October 23rd, 24th, and 25th. We also cover things like the 5th National Climate Assessment, the Sustainable Energy in America Factbook. We do briefings every few months looking at how the Inflation Reduction Act and Infrastructure Investment Jobs Act are being implemented. We look at technology and innovation like carbon dioxide removal. Nature-based solutions is a favorite, and even more to come. That may sound like a lot, and it is. If you'd like to keep up with what we're doing and you haven't already subscribed to our biweekly newsletter, Climate Change Solutions, as soon as you're done your sandwiches, it'll be a great time to do it because the next issue comes out this afternoon. I think it's scheduled to send at like 3. So you've got 3 hours-ish to sign up. It's a great resource. We also have our legislation trackers, our hearing trackers, and all sorts of great information. A few years ago, EESI organized a 16-part briefing series about regional coastal resilience. It was really popular, and even though some of the briefings date all the way back to 2019, it actually really holds up. We moved from Maine to Wisconsin to Hawaii to help people learn about the experiences of coastal communities. We decided to write a report about it, A Resilient Future for Coastal Communities, Federal Policy Recommendations from Solutions in Practice. The report is a compilation of all the findings and policy ideas presented by 42 policy experts and coastal resilience practitioners who participated in the briefing series. You can find that online at www.eesi.org. And as it happened, just yesterday, we held a session at the Restore America's Estuary Summit about the report findings and recommendations, as well as the progress made by the historic investments in climate action provided by Congress and what remains to be done. We care a lot about communities on the coast, and we realized that there was a missing piece and we weren't spending enough time looking at the experiences of riverine communities. And so we've decided to do a new briefing series. Today is the kickoff for that. We needed to cover riverine community resilience in a comprehensive way with a dedicated briefing series, and we're really, really excited to kick it off. The first briefing today is about the environmental challenges facing the Mississippi River. The Mississippi River is many things to a lot of people across 10 states. It supports tourism, commerce, biodiversity, and recreation. Its economic impacts reach the entire nation. Hundreds of millions of tons of freight is moved along the river system. Millions of jobs are supported. It's home to all sorts of birds and fish and mammals and amphibians and other critters. And like all rivers, the Mississippi and the communities that depend on it face challenges like nitrate pollution, saltwater intrusion, flooding, and low water levels. And many of those are exacerbated by climate change. And our panelists, and we have a tremendous 5-person panel today, will help you understand how all of those things flow together. We'll also have this slide at the end. If you are so moved and would like to take our survey, we really appreciate that. We read every response. And you'd like to come back and do that at the end, of course, you'd be welcome to do that. We have 5 really excellent panelists. I'll introduce the first one in just a second. We'll also have time today for Q&A. And so if you have questions, hang on to them. We'll make sure we'll do our best to get to you. If you're in our online audience, and I know there are many of you in our online audience today, you can follow us on social media at EESI Online. You can also send your email. You can email us your questions, and the email address to use is ask, that's ASK, at EESI.org. We'll be doing real-time coverage on our Instagram story and X. And that brings us to our first panelist today. Colin Wellenkamp is the executive director of the Mississippi River Cities and Towns Initiative. Colin is a highly experienced leader in sustainable development and environmental policy with a career spanning over two decades. The Mississippi River Towns, Cities and Towns Initiative is a coalition of 102 mayors across 10 states to restore the economy and ecology of the Mississippi corridor. Colin has worked extensively with lawmakers, Fortune 500 companies, and international investors to develop climate resilient strategies and infrastructure investments. Colin, thank you so much for making your way to DC today for the briefing. I'll turn it over to you. The clicker's right there.
Thank you so much, Daniel. Pleasure to be here, invited, and we appreciate our ongoing partnership with EESI, which has spanned the planet now, right? From North America to Asia to Middle East. We've been together on a lot of trips to those COPs that were mentioned, and we hope more to come. There's plenty of work to come. Good morning if you're from the Mississippi River Corridor, where I'm from. My home in Missouri is still morning there. Good afternoon here on the East Coast. And as stated, I'm Colin Wellenkamp. I'm the executive director of MRCTI. And we are an association of now 105 mayors. So we've added three since Dan got that statistic. No problemo. We have 124 mayor-led municipalities along the Mississippi River in 10 states. 105 of those cities are a member of our association. So just a few holdouts, but don't worry, we're going to get them. We're going to get there. And these are just a few pictures and images of our mayors in action on the ground in different places on the corridor, from Kimswick, Missouri, at the top there, standing next to the mayor of East St. Louis, Illinois, Mayor Carter of St. Paul, Mayor of Bettendorf, Iowa, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, the previous mayor of Memphis, Tennessee, and of course our rock star mayor, Eric Simmons of Greenville, Mississippi. So all of these mayors are very busy and they're very ambitious about keeping ahead of the climate impacts that our corridor is sustaining. So ambitious that they have developed a plan to restore this vital resource that goes through the mid-continent region of North America. And they believe that they can do this through a combination of partnerships and rethinking and reapproaching how environmental work is done in tandem with municipal management, county management, and state management across several economies. And what that looks like on the ground and how we do that, going to get to in a minute. But first of all, why the Mississippi River? What's so important about this river? Why so much activity, so much concentration on it? Well, to put it mildly, it is the most important working river on the planet. The Mississippi River Corridor, which is a 10-state corridor along the main stem, is the linchpin of the larger 31-state Mississippi River Basin. And we'll get to that, what that implication is for the rest of the planet in a minute. This is our leadership. Our leaders are, this year, Mayor Mitch Reynolds of La Crosse, Vicksburg, Blytheville, and Muscatine. That's a picture of all of our mayors at the bottom there. Last year in Bemidji, Minnesota, at the headwaters of the Mississippi. Just out of curiosity, how many folks in the room have been to the headwaters in the Mississippi? Okay, not very many. It's a transformative experience in your life. It's up there with the Holy Land, I would say. It really is. You can feel the power of the river birthing underneath you as you step into it and cross the Mississippi on foot, which is not far from where that photo was taken. Right behind them is Lake Bemidji, which is one of the early lakes that the Mississippi spills into. I didn't include it here, but we have a photo of the mayor of Baton Rouge, Louisiana, leading a group of mayors through Middle America all the way up to Minnesota across the Mississippi River barefoot through the sand in Bemidji. It's quite a sight. And I would recommend everybody try it. This was a historic meeting for us because for the first time, we signed an agreement between Mississippi River mayors and Native American tribes, the First Nations of the Mississippi River, three of them. Only one is left in the U.S. whose original homeland is still alongside the Mississippi River, and they're still there. Only one, and that's the Red Lake Nation. So this is what we're implicating here. That is a blue graphic showing the drainage basin of the mid-continent region of the Mississippi River, two Canadian provinces and 31 states. This is a responsible for 40% of the world's food supply. 1 in 12 people on Earth consume commodities from the Mississippi River basin, moved on the main stem, Mississippi. I'll give you some examples. So the Middle East has been in the news a little bit as of late. And it was brought to our attention recently, 15 to 19% of the food supply for the Middle East comes from the Mississippi River Basin. 10% of that is from, comes from the United States. 10% of that comes from the Mississippi River Basin. Over 8% of Israel's food supply comes out of our basin. So the global implications of our basin are paramount. Ukraine gets over 23%. Eastern Europe gets over 23% of its food supply from the Mississippi River Basin. So when the Dnieper River became compromised by war as a food-producing river basin, they actually, Eastern Europe, started turning more to the Mississippi River Basin to pick up the slack. And we, through the Port of New Orleans, we worked with the Port of New Orleans to increase that supply. So global stability, global food supply, global politics, and the global commodity supply chain are all dependent in large part by the performance and the ecological stability and integrity of this basin. So that's what's at stake. And that's why these mayors are acting at a very global level. Going to the COPs, going to the G10, G7, G20 summits, going to the World and Global Water Summits, the biodiversity summits, the Mississippi River must have a seat at the table because of its outweighed global importance. These are mayors at the last COP in Dubai and the one before that in Egypt. That's Mayor Simmons standing next to Bloomberg. Michael Bloomberg at the opening press conference of COP27 in Egypt. These are the mayors of New Orleans, Dubuque, Iowa, Greenville, Mississippi, and La Crosse, Wisconsin in Dubai last year for COP28. We have been successful in moving the needle inside the Paris Accord framework for ecological adaptation and mitigation. We have not been successful yet in creating a food security provision in the Paris Accord. We are working on that. That is a major aim of our mayors. This COP coming up next month, as a matter of fact, in Azerbaijan, this will be the COP, we're told, will be the first session to actually determine a working definition of transformative adaptation. It's in the Paris Accord, but it's not defined. We believe defining transformative adaptation across corridor and basin scale is absolutely critical for moving forward. How are we doing this back home? Well, keeping the Mississippi River functioning as an economy and an ecological system is dependent on our cities having resilient built infrastructure that can weather intense heat, floods, and now more frequently and more costly, droughts. That can only be done. We can only protect the built infrastructure by restoring and expanding the natural infrastructure. The natural infrastructure is the only opportunity where our mayors can realize co-benefits for multiple hazards in a way, in a framework that we can afford. We're not going to levy and floodwall our way out of this. We're not going to concrete line our way out of this either. And that infrastructure only has one-dimensional benefits. If we deploy wetlands, marshes, forests, not only do we solve multiple problems, but we also enrich and make more resilient multiple economies, including our freshwater economy, which is the most important one on the Mississippi. Why? Because it supports the largest economy on the Mississippi River, which is manufacturing. Most of the manufacturing along the Mississippi is freshwater dependent. It's a $500 billion implication to our nation, and 5% of U.S. GDP is dependent on the economies functioning up and down that river. We have partnered with Ducks Unlimited to deploy the Mississippi River's largest non-federal natural infrastructure project pipeline. 100,000 acres across 9 states, 45 cities, and that's just the beginning. Over $100 million in investment between now and 2030 to onboard these clusters of natural infrastructure emphasis areas that you see there. Each of the yellow circles highlight an area that was outlined for us on the conducting the nation's largest private climate vulnerability study in the Mid-Continent region. That was spearheaded by our mayors and 2 Degrees of DAPT out of Minneapolis. So this is what those co-benefits are. This is what we're seeking. We're looking at 8 hours of peak flood protection off of the using the largest and longest flood in U.S. history, 2019. 270 consecutive days of flooding. Unprecedented. 11.5 million pounds of nutrient captured. Katie will Playhive will particularly like and be interested in that stat. And then the carbon sequestration. All told, what are we trying to do? What are we trying to get to? We're trying to reduce the cost of a singular $1 billion disaster event by 20% by half maturity point of these natural assets. That's what we're trying to get to. That is the moonshot deal here. These are the baby steps, big baby, baby steps in between all of that. And this is what we're deploying. I mentioned the wetlands, the marshes, but also connected floodplain. So much of the Mississippi River has been disconnected from the rest of its natural spread out areas by us, cities, development, agriculture, communities over the last 125 years. We need to reconnect those areas back to the main channel so that drainage and the river can take place and drainage has somewhere to go. This is just a picture of one of our projects. You can see downtown St. Louis in the deep background there. You can almost make out the arch and the skyscrapers. That's Horseshoe Lake in the midground. And right there in the foreground is the wetland, marsh, and forest that we're building with Ducks Unlimited. This got an unscheduled test run in July of 2022. It was the largest torrential rain event in St. Louis history. It's a 1,000-year rain event. That asset behaved as predicted beautifully. We were able to onboard over 800 Olympic-sized swimming pools worth of water that would have gone into basements, small businesses, and downtown communities that are already economically disadvantaged, like East St. Louis, Illinois. So that's just want to wrap it up, and that's not me. That's Sarah. That's next. Just by one little plug, and that is there is also critically federal legislation that can help with this work specifically that we're working on. It's called the Safeguarding the Mississippi River Together Act, the SMART Act. It was introduced by Benny Thompson in the summer of 2021. We're retooling it and bringing it back for another go in the next session in January. We've already passed parts of that bill. It was a bipartisan effort spearheaded by Senator Bozeman and Senator Wicker and Senator Cassidy of Louisiana. And that was the Lower Mississippi River Ecological Demonstration Program. That enabled us for the first time in U.S. history to have a singular Mississippi River Environmental Restoration Program for the whole river. It was bipartisan. Republicans and Democrats working together, sitting down, talking it out. The SMART Act wants to take a few steps further and create the nation's first national federal Mississippi River program. We have one for the Missouri River. We have one for the Rio Grande. Did you know that? The Rio Grande has a federal program. We have one for the Chesapeake Bay, the Everglades, and the Great Lakes. But we don't have one for the world's most important riverine region. And we hope to change that. And we hope all of you will help us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Colin. That was a great presentation. You kind of gave away the game here. Next up is Sarah Murdoch. Sarah is the Senior Director of U.S. Lands and Waters Policy with the Nature Conservancy. And you might remember Sarah because she joined us for our 2019 briefing about nature-based resilience for Gulf Coast communities. Sarah's career has spanned more than 30 years of work in the public, private, and nonprofit sector in environmental energy policy. Sarah, thank you so much for joining us today. I'll turn it over to you.
Get this to stand up. Hello, everyone. Thank you to EESI, to Dan and staff for putting this together. It's an honor to be here, and I love talking about the Nature Conservancy's work on the Mississippi River. So I'm going to start by just giving a little bit of overview of how the Nature Conservancy is approaching its work on the Mississippi River Basin. You heard some great context from Colin, and I'll just build on that a little bit. But the Nature Conservancy, for those of you who don't know, we're an international nonprofit that works to protect the land and waters on which life depends. We work in all 50 states, and we work in 72 countries at this point. And so we have the benefit in the Mississippi River to work in all of the 31 states that make up the Mississippi River Basin. Our goals that are detailed up here on the slide, and I won't go through them in detail, but just to say our overarching goals really are about reducing nutrients and protecting and restoring floodplains across the basin. Because we have a presence in all 31 states, our program pulls together our staff and our on-the-ground work to work in a really coordinated and collaborative manner amongst all of our state chapters as we seek to demonstrate what success looks like, drive change on the ground, and leverage policy to scale the work faster. So as Colin shared, the Mississippi River and its tributaries brings food, and now I know the stats on how much it brings food globally, but it's fresh water, jobs, economic security to the millions of Americans who live in the communities along the basin and who depend on a healthy river. Yet flooding, agriculture runoff, aging infrastructure, low water disruption to navigation that's become increasingly a threat, sinking lands, they're just some of the challenges of maintaining a resilient river. So I'm going to talk a little bit just about a couple of the science work that TNC is leading. And this first one is really, first of all, making the point that in order to address the challenges that face this basin and other basins other basins as well, but particularly in this basin, we need to have science and data to guide the work. If we're collectively going to address the multiple challenges that face communities, the agriculture, the infrastructure, and the environment, actions must be informed by the latest science. So given this, TNC convened science experts throughout the basin, made up of federal, state agency, technical advisors, academics, and other NGOs, to design a comprehensive monitoring system for the basin. The question driving the work was, is the current monitoring system in the Mississippi River Basin adequate to determine the levels of risk and the effects of actions to mitigate those risks? So the goal of the effort was to develop recommendations for an updated monitoring system. The group produced a report that lays out the details. This was led by my colleague, Brian Piazza, who is based in Louisiana. And I've shared a copy of that report with EESI, so I assume that will get posted after the briefing for anybody who's interested in diving into that. So the system deployed throughout the basin would provide a standardized information on present and future flooding and flood risk, water quality and sediments, and ecosystem health. It will provide information that can be used for river forecasting, flood inundation mapping, sediment transport and deposition, community resilience, conservation, restoration, and navigation. So the estimated cost to develop this new integrated monitoring system, so it builds off of an existing system that has become outdated and antiquated. So this new monitoring system that meets quality standards and provides timely, readily accessible data to multiple public users would be about $359 million over 25 years. So we're looking forward to working with Congress in 2025 to secure the funding to begin to invest in the system and put the comprehensive monitoring system in place. Another piece of science work I'll just touch on is that was led by TNC scientists. Sets out to create an interactive web-based GIS tool that identifies critical opportunities for floodplain conservation and restoration. We call it our floodplain prioritization tool. So the tool helps to identify places where actions would have the greatest impact on the overall health of the river. Our goal has been to drive investments in nature-based solutions, and share that goal with the work of the mayors as well. And we've worked over the years with various federal agencies, such as the Army Corps. We've worked on WERDAs to insert authorization language on provisions that mandate consideration of nature-based solutions. We've worked with agencies like FEMA to drive increased investment in nature-based solutions with FEMA funding and NRCS to implement floodplain restoration projects. So the tool allows for users to identify priorities and assess trade-offs related to nutrient removal, wildlife habitat, flooding, and other goals. It's been used to inform a collaborative floodplain management plan for Missouri's Lower Merrimack River, and that was guided by an integrated multidisciplinary planning process through an Army Corps Silver Jackets program, if you're aware of that program. And then most recently, the tool has been used again, through a Silver Jackets multidisciplinary planning process, working to address challenges of the Trinity floodplain in Texas. So not in the Mississippi River Basin, but an example of how it can be adapted and applied in other places. So this version of the tool assesses water quality, habitat, carbon storage, flood risk to communities and agriculture, development pressure, and it contains other supporting overlays like land cover, priority conservation areas, and flood losses. It's been used to screen for potential Army Corps Section 1135 environmental restoration sites. They screened for unprotected floodplain, near protected land, areas in a five-year frequency, flooding frequency, that contribute sediment loading to an Army Corps reservoir site. So those were the screening criteria to come up with sites that might potentially be eligible and where Section 1185 funding could be used. So we're developing other tools as well. Our goal is to overall is just to drive more federal resources to be invested in nature-based solutions throughout the Mississippi River Basin. The aim is to develop tools to be used by communities to identify and design nature-based solutions and to help drive federal resources like FEMA, Army Corps, and NRCS, and other federal resources. So we'll continue to work with Congress through various legislation like WERDA, like the Farm Bill, and appropriations to advance enabling conditions and funding that promotes investments in nature-based solutions. So I just want to close with mentioning an effort that we're helping lead and with engagement with partners like MRCTI, NWF, and EPA. And it's a Mississippi River Watershed partnership that we have been working. And it's similar to address the challenge that Colin mentioned is that there is no comprehensive program for the Mississippi River. And this is really something many of us are working on in different fronts to try to address. So a partner from the Corps said it really well. There are a lot of islands of good across the basin, but nothing that really connects those islands together. We're working to create consensus around the benefits of basin-wide structure and the benefits of creating a shared set of goals spanning water quality, flood, droughts, inland navigation, fish and wildlife resources, and recreation. A good example of something we want to build on is the collaboration and shared investment in the Upper Mississippi River through the Upper Mississippi River Restoration Program, UMRR. UMRR was the first federal program to combine ecosystem restoration monitoring and science on a large river system. It combines the environmental long-term resource monitoring, research, systemic data acquisition, and modeling to provide a solid scientific foundation upon which many agencies base management actions and policy. So we want to explore and determine how a program like UMMR could be replicated in other parts of the basin to holistically manage actions, policy, and investments in service of the goal to create a healthy and resilient watersheds, Mississippi River watershed. So thank you very much for the opportunity. And if anybody is interested in the partnership and wanting to learn more about it, please let me know and come and speak to me. Thank you.
I'll turn this to you. There you go. That was great. Yes. So Sarah mentioned the report. If you visit us, if you visit the briefing page for today at www.esi.org, that's where you can access the webcast. So if you want to go back and watch anything again, presentation materials, all of the slides, reports for sure, and lots of great resources. We also have a printout or printouts of the slides from today out on the front table. So if you didn't catch that on your way in, you can grab one hopefully on the way out. Also, a quick reminder, we will have time for Q&A today. So if you have questions in the room, I don't think we have a wireless mic today, so we'll just make sure we speak loudly and I'll repeat the questions into this mic so our webcast can hear us. But we will definitely have time for Q&A. And if you're in our online audience, you can send us questions to ask, that's ask, at EESI.org. That brings us to Amanda Moore. Amanda is the Senior Director of the Gulf Program with the National Wildlife Federation. Amanda leads program efforts across the Gulf Coast and along the Mississippi River to build more resilient communities and wildlife habitat. She specializes in stakeholder engagement and collaborative partnership building with government officials, community leaders, and technical experts to advance conservation solutions. Amanda, welcome to the briefing today. I'll turn it over to you.
Hello. It's very nice to be here. Thank you, EESI, for hosting this and allowing us to talk about the health of the Mississippi River today, which is so important. The Mississippi River is a big priority for the National Wildlife Federation. We have program work from sustainable agriculture to advancing natural infrastructure to restoring the Mississippi River Delta. that have long been priorities for our organization. We have 52 affiliates, state-based and territorial affiliates as well, and of course 10 affiliates along each of the main STEM states. And so you've heard a lot today about the importance of the Mississippi River already, but just to emphasize a few more interesting statistics that you just can't gloss over when it comes to the importance of the Mississippi River. It drives a vibrant and natural resource and recreation-based economy that generates nearly $500 billion in annual revenue. It directly employs more than 1.5 million people. The river provides more than 643 million gallons of water each day for domestic and industrial uses along the corridor and supplies drinking water for more than 20 million people in 50 cities. On the wildlife side, as we like to point out, the Mississippi River supports more than 780 species of fish and wildlife and provides a vital migration corridor for 60% of all of North American birds and 40% of the nation's migratory waterfowl. Hundreds of miles of the river are adjacent to national wildlife refuges and other important habitat. And today, we're going to hit on a few different topics. And things that Congress can do to help support the resilience of the Mississippi River. So first, we want to talk about the Mississippi River Restoration and Resilience Initiative Act, or known as MRI by many. Despite, you know, everything that you've heard about the importance of the Mississippi River, the river is in a severe state of decline that is not being stemmed by existing federal programs. And as you've heard, we need to rethink the way that we work on the river. MRI would create a framework, a focus, and critical coordination needed to reverse the decline of the river. Under this non-regulatory initiative, this is modeled after the really successful Great Lakes Restoration Initiative. The EPA would take the lead in developing and coordinating MRI and implementing its action plan in close coordination and consultation with federal agencies, tribes, local governments, and NGOs. MRI would work to leverage existing federal and state programs where appropriate and would create economic opportunities and well-paying locally based jobs. The bill also creates a network of Mississippi River Science Centers via the USGS and main STEM states. And then, as you see on the slide, four areas that MRI would work to prioritize and support: improving water quality, improving community resilience, protecting and restoring wildlife habitat, and protecting vulnerable communities. One more thing on MRI. After the election this year, there's talk about holding a House Transportation and Infrastructure Committee hearing to review some geographic bills, and we would like to see MRI that happen and MRI included. Clean Water Act. If you're here today because you're concerned about the health of the river, you should be concerned about the 2023 Supreme Court decision on Sackett versus EPA. Water quality and flood storage areas along the entire river are hugely threatened by the recent rollback of basic federal pollution and destruction protections under the Clean Water Act for streams and wetlands caused by the 2023 Sackett versus EPA decision. And this is placing communities and wildlife at risk. Over 50% of the water that reaches the Delta originates in streams that might not be federally protected against pollution and destruction. According to the EPA, almost two-thirds of previously protected wetlands are no longer protected by the Clean Water Act against being degraded or destroyed. And a recent assessment indicated that wetlands are no longer federally protected, and the Mississippi River Basin itself mirrors that two-thirds. And one of the impacts of this is that it will put trillions of gallons of flood storage areas at risk of being lost throughout the basin, which of course we know would be very detrimental. So without this strong federal baseline that adequately protects waters nationwide, the burden will then fall on states and localities to protect their streams and wetlands. And what we've known historically is that this has not been enough to ensure protection of our waters. So we're asking Congress to step up to address the harm done by the Sackett decision and ensure federal safeguards for all important waters. And we also would like to see Congress support state and tribal efforts to enact or strengthen protection for waters that we all rely on. This includes increasing funding for key federal wetland conservation programs like NACA and the EPA's Wetlands Protection, Wetland Program Development Grants. Next up, disaster funding, which is of course top of mind for so many Right now, with the impacts of Helene and Milton buried down on the Gulf Coast of Florida, and obviously we know post-disaster funding, super critical, but we want to talk today about the important role of funding for both before and after disasters. So with extreme weather and changing climate now more than ever, Congress needs to do more to fund pre-disaster mitigation and planning in states all up and down the Mississippi River. We have seen in areas like the Mississippi River Delta the ways that investments in planning capacity can lead to better projects, and regularly available funding for implementation can allow for state-led projects that reduce flood damage and restore the environment. We also wanted to lift up a couple of programs and plans right now that are doing good work in this area. Of course, FEMA's BRIC program and STORM programs are AIM funding for pre-disaster and resiliency. And then the Army Corps is doing some great work managing the river for heightened climate risk and severe weather. I wanted to call out the Lower Mississippi River Comprehensive Management Study. The map on the screen is the vicinity map for what that study covers. This was authorized in WERDA 2022, and it's a five-year, $25 million mega study that evaluates alternatives for ensuring effective long-term management of the river from Cape Girardeau to the Gulf of Mexico. And this, it truly is comprehensive. It's really impressive, the work they're doing already. They're covering issues like hurricane and storm damage reduction, flood risk management, ecosystem, environmental restoration, water supply, recreation, much more. So happy to see that moving forward and being prioritized. And then turning to the Mississippi River Delta. So this is a place where I've focused a lot of my work for the last 15 years. And really everything that we're talking about today, because of the geography of the Delta, all of the issues across the panel will manifest in the Mississippi River Delta. We have flooding, surge, heat, hypoxia, environmental justice issues. We have a highly engineered system from federal, state, local infrastructure. And we also have a very important ecosystem in the Delta. That ecosystem is under threat from a lot of different challenges, including levying off the river from its connection to its delta, massive navigation channels like the Mississippi River Gulf Outlet, climate challenges like sea level rise, some of the highest sea level rise rates in the country or in the delta, habitat loss, more extreme storms. And you put all that together, and the delta is actually experiencing some of the highest land loss rates in the world. They experience a football field of wetlands are lost every 100 minutes in the Delta. So unfortunately, what this region experiences is often a precursor to what other coastal areas will experience and the types of impacts. And the great thing is that the river is really at the heart of the solutions of how we're dealing with the issues facing the Mississippi River Delta. Our successes are largely thanks to these three main pillars on the slide. Governance rooted in the science-based planning process, dedicated protected funding streams that give us a strong record of implementation, a lot of consistency and ability to plan and be strategic about how we do our restoration work. And then lastly, but not least, the public trust and support that has been really prioritized, not just by the state, but also by the communities and NGOs, universities. All of this, the restoration and the issues facing the Delta are very prioritized and widely supported in Louisiana. And right now, we're adjusting to a big change in administration at the state level, and it's really reinforced the value of having really broad, widespread public support awareness about the issues at hand, the solutions at hand, to help keep some stability in the coastal program in Louisiana. This engagement is really critical. We've seen some federally funded federal funding available for this type of program and community engagement support, but we'd love to see it be more of the norm and more prioritized. And then just to wrap up, touch a little bit on community engagement. We do a lot of this at National Wildlife Federation, and just some examples of some of the media work we do in coastal Louisiana to talk about the science-based planning process and show the stakeholder support. We bring the landowners directly with the planners and policymakers, connect them a lot. We reach out to different stakeholder groups, like sportsmen, faith leaders, and also work very closely with scientists and government and get people out in the field a lot to see what the restoration looks like, and that's really important. Finally, I just want to touch really quickly on a study that we did in 2022. We did a network mapping project along the 10 main SAM states, and we worked with, did detailed interviews with 70 diverse stakeholders with different backgrounds and a wealth of perspectives on the Mississippi River and how to advance natural infrastructure and build resilience. And some of the themes we see are here. And then a few takeaways. I mean, at the top of the heap is the importance of working with the community and the community level, empowering residents and really helping to leverage the government programs that are out there and helping them know how to do that. One that's really stood out to me that was really interesting that I wanted to bring up is the number three, the relationship overhauling with the river. All maybe not so much in the headwaters, but maybe the rest of the river, there's such a disconnect from the river itself, and it's such an amazing resource that we have. And I think a lot of, you know, the work that we need to do in the river starts with rethinking our relationship with the river and celebrating the river, reconnecting people to the river. And that's something that we heard time and time again. And then these other things that we're doing on number seven, capacity and technical assistance, it's something that we've recognized in the Mississippi Alluvial Valley. And are working with communities there to try to think about how do we fill those capacity gaps and technical needs and help advance, you know, restoration there and take advantage of all the federal funding and opportunity. So thank you so much.
Just going to do that. So, Mandy, I have to ask you, I don't work at the National Wildlife Foundation.
Federation, excuse me.
But... raccoons don't normally wear hats. Did he take the hat? Did he steal the hat? What happened to the ranger?
I was not involved with decision.
It's so funny. I like.
Yeah, that's Ranger Rick.
Oh, okay, okay. Well, I still think he's up to no good.
It's an interesting silhouette of Ranger Rick.
Yeah, he's like he's up to something. He's like sitting on a. Yeah. Anyway, I don't trust him.
He's a guardian from the wild.
All right. Great. Well, I thought it was hilarious. That brings us to our next panelist. Katie Flahive is the U.S. EPA and Mississippi River Gulf of Mexico Hypoxia Task Force Coordinating Committee co-chair. Katie is also an agricultural engineer with the Nonpoint Source Management Program at EPA headquarters. Katie works with federal, state, nonprofit, and industry partners that research, develop, implement, track, and measure the results of voluntary and/or incentive-based controls to improve water quality. Water quality in agricultural and rural areas, and she coordinates the Hypoxia Task Force as the federal co-chair of the coordinating committee. Katie, thank you so much for joining us today. I'm really looking forward to it. And do you have any small mammals wearing?
I don't.
Okay, haberdashery? Okay.
Haberdashery.
Well, thank you so much for the warm welcome, and thank you for the opportunity to be here and share what EPA is doing. You mentioned that I coordinate the Hypoxia Task Force Coordinating Committee. I'm going to talk about that. So from that perspective, I am here to amplify the voices of the states, tribes, and the partners that we work with through that organization. So today I'm going to talk about agricultural nonpoint source pollution in the Mississippi River Basin. Thanks, Colin, for the heads up introduction on the importance of those reductions that you all are working so hard on. The problems associated with Gulf hypoxia in the northern Gulf of Mexico, the role of the task force in encouraging collaboration and solutions to these issues, and the opportunity that the IIJA Gulf hypoxia program has provided in the recent past to meet these challenges. So I'm not going to cover this, but I'm focused on that little red part of this map at the bottom of the Mississippi River. So thank you to the previous speakers for talking about the basin. So what does agricultural nonpoint source pollution look like in the basin? It is 31 states. There's two Canadian provinces that contribute as well to the water in this watershed. There's multiple scales of ways that we can look at the data. We rely heavily on USGS and USDA's Sparrow and SEEP reports, respectively. These are key tools for us to understand nitrogen and phosphorus pollution in the basin. On the left side is USDA's SEEP program, the output from their first assessment. And the yellow represents the nitrogen and phosphorus pollution from cultivated cropland that is delivered to the Gulf. It's kind of hard to see. These slides are shared. I'd be happy to share this with anyone interested. On the right is USGS's sparrow output. And this the orange and green represents the agricultural non-point sources that deliver nitrogen and phosphorus. So these are the data sets that tell us what we need to be focused on. You can see why we're working to support the states and tribes as they work to reduce this pollution that's delivered to the Gulf. So what is hypoxia? Quickly, the nutrient pollution, when it is delivered to the Gulf, allows for the formation of an algal bloom. And when those algae die off, the zone of low oxygen forms at a level that does not sustain aquatic life. So you can kind of see that process. The flow of the pollution, the algal bloom forms, the algae die, drop to the bottom, the oxygen decreases. So what are we doing about this? The task force and its coordinating committee is a partnership of 5 federal agencies, 12 states, and a tribal representative from the National Tribal Water Council. The states are in the lead in implementing their own nutrient reduction strategies, and the federal agencies provide the needed resources where available and possible. The states are represented by a variety of their agricultural, water quality, and natural resource agencies, while each state has one official task force member. Many of the states have multiple agencies sitting at the table with the staff-level coordinating committee working on these issues. EPA is the federal co-chair, and Iowa is the state co-chair. And these collection of governmental agencies provide a forum for a holistic approach to reach our goal, which I'll get into in a moment. But first, a little background on this task force. It's been around a long time. It was formed in the late 90s, an outcome of the 1998 Harmful Algal Bloom and Hypoxia Research and Control Act, also referred to as HBARCA. The continued authorization of this work supports multiple layers of work that the Hypoxia Task Force can accomplish. This was the genesis of the task force. The HBARCA bill particularly kicked off the scientific inquiry and assessment of the challenges and issues in the Mississippi River Basin. That inquiry led to the task force's adoption of the 2001 action plan, which established the goal to reduce the size of the hypoxic zone. In the mid-2000s, this drove a lot of interest in a lot of academic research and understanding of new science. A science reassessment was conducted through the EPA Science Advisory Board and how to integrate that and made recommendations to the task force on how to integrate that newfound understanding into action. And the task force updated the action plan in 2008 to call for a dual nitrogen and phosphorus reduction strategy with the state-level nutrient reduction strategies as the blueprint for success. In 2015, the task force reiterated the goal and adopted an interim target of 20% nitrogen and phosphorus reduction by 2025, coming up next year. So we're looking forward to sharing a lot of information in the coming year. Most recently in 2022, the IIJA allowed EPA to establish the Gulf Hypoxia Program, which is the first time investment in these in the work of the states to reach those challenging action plan goals. So what are our goals? I'm just going to mention quickly the main goal. I'm not going to read everything here, but the main goal of the Hypoxia Task Force is to reduce the size of the Northern Gulf Hypoxia Zone to less than 5,000 square kilometers by the year 2035. We acknowledge in our goal that there are a number of resources that will be needed to make this happen. And we have an interim target that I mentioned of the 20% reduction in nitrogen and phosphorus by next year. So where are we? You can see here, this is the NOAA measures the size of the hypoxic zone annually. Since 1985, we've had this data. While nutrients fuel the dead zone, a number of other factors impact the size of the zone from year to year. This includes rainfall upstream, temperature of the waters and in throughout the basin, and mixing of waters offshore. So I'm not going to get into a lot of these scientific details today, but I just want to use this to illustrate that we have very challenging goals. And the states and the tribes and the federal agencies are not afraid of those challenges, but we recognize how challenging they are. So what do we know right now? I'm not going to read all of this, but NOAA supports a suite of models. And what do they tell us? That the interim goal for load reduction, when we reach that 20% nitrogen and phosphorus reduction, though a large hypoxic zone is likely to persist, this point of nutrient reduction delivered from the basin brings the system closer to an inflection point where measurable decreases in the zone size can be expected with continued future reductions. The current status, we rely on USGS to produce this data for us. Basically, from the baseline, that black line for nitrogen, we're floating below our interim target. For phosphorus, it's a different story. There's a lot that we're learning about how phosphorus acts in the environment that we can help as we advance continuing to implement the state nutrient reduction strategies. So here's basically how do we measure, and I appreciated what you were talking about, the monitoring in the basin. That's key to our understanding. We use models, we use regional scale information. We use a lot of different tools at our hands at different scales in order to help track. I'm not going to go into all of these, but we do publish a biennial report to Congress, and that information is shared in there. I do want to talk briefly about the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act Gulf Hypoxia Program. This is a historic opportunity for the task force. This was the first time investment in the action plan. So up until this point, states have been using their Clean Water Act funding, 319, SRF, 106, all of those to advance what's able to happen on the landscape. But this was an important piece in engaging with the IRA as well as through partnership through NRCS. And I just want to show a really brief snapshot of the types of projects. These are the types of projects that we're seeing on the ground. There's 115 projects on the ground right now since 2022 by the 12 states, 15 tribes, and three partner entities, the sub-basin committees and a land-grant university consortium. And so just an opportunity to engage with us. The states invite folks at the local level to work with them. They host public meetings. The task force, we host public meetings. We have a success stories story map on our website. We do produce these biennial reports to Congress, which talk collectively about everything that everyone is doing. They're kind of long. But if you have any questions on them, we'd be happy to point you to key parts in it. We have a Hypoxia Task Force quarterly newsletter that we use to amplify the voices of the states and as they roll out their programs and information. And you can engage at any time with the Hypoxia Task Force. You can submit an email, you can call us, you can contact your state contacts, et cetera. So thank you again for the opportunity to be here today.
Katie, I'll trade you. Oh, you're fine. That was great. Thank you very much. And I think there are some folks from EPA Congressional Affairs here today, too, mm-hmm. right? So if staff have any questions and want to follow up with you, she took the cue. thanks so much for that. That brings us to our fifth presenter today. Magali Rojas is the Community Engagement Coordinator for the Heartland Environmental Justice Center. Magali works with Heartland to provide federal funding assistance to grassroots organizations across Iowa, Kansas, Missouri, Nebraska, and adjoining indigenous nations. As an environmental justice advocate, she has a background in environmental assessment and is a member of the Hispanic Access Conservation Network. Welcome to our briefing today. I brought your slides up, and I'm really looking forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Walking up there, I invite you to take a moment to just stand up and if you like and just
or just in your chair, just wiggle around. Yes, take a time to just breathe. Breathe and just think about what you're going to listen to, because this presentation is one that is powerful, is one that has my experience with 6 years nonprofit experience. It is one that has environmental justice and the people. And I'd like to start off with reading you an excerpt. And this excerpt is written by, he is a Filipino novelist and a poet, Carlos Bulosan. And this is an essay that was crafted in 1943. And it was crafted from Norman Rockwell's Freedom from Want. We march on those sometimes strange moods, although sometimes strange moods fill our children. Our march toward security and peace is the march of freedom, the freedom that we should like to become a living part of. It is the dignity of the individual to live in a society of free men, where the spirit of understanding and belief exist. Of understanding that all men are equal, that all men, whatever their color, race, religion, or estate, should be given opportunity to serve themselves and each other according to their needs and abilities. But we are not really free unless we use what we produce. So long as the fruit of our labor is denied us, so long will want manifest itself in a world of slaves. It is only when we have plenty to eat, plenty of everything, that we begin to understand what freedom means. To us, freedom is not an intangible thing. When we have enough to eat, then we are healthy enough to enjoy what we eat. Then we have the time and ability to read and think and discuss things. Then we are not merely living, but also becoming a creative part of life. It is only then that we become a growing part of democracy. I didn't write that, remember. So, a few definitions here for you. Environmental justice, this is a definition from the EPA. So it's the just treatment and meaningful involvement of all people, regardless of income, race, color, national origin, tribe affiliation, disability, and that affect an agency decision making and other federal activities that affect human health and the environment. And then we also have energy justice. So this is a definition from Department of Energy. It is the goal of achieving equity in both the social and economic participation in the energy system while also remediating social, economic, and health burdens on those disproportionately harmed and by the energy systems. And lastly, a little bit about the Thriving Communities Technical Assistance Center. So these centers are meant to provide training and other assistance to build capacity for navigating federal grant application systems, developing strong grant proposals, and effectively managing grant funding. EPA has selected 16 EJ TICTACs in partnership with the US Department of Energy. And here to the left, you see this picture, Justice on Climate, Race and Immigration. So with that, I'm going to share another story here. This story was based on real life. It does not use any real names. Emily Sanchez came to the nonprofit organization where they provided a holistic approach of services such as health, education, economic, and civic engagement. They know the community they serve, and they are funded through less restrictive grants. This nonprofit is well known for working as a team rather than in silos. Emily Sanchez scheduled an appointment to see the health navigator. She shares with the health navigator that she is a 27-year-old woman from Venezuela. She moved to Kansas City 3 months ago from Florida with her three kids. She came in because she needs help with a tooth extraction. She doesn't have medical insurance, and someone referred her to this nonprofit where they speak her language, Spanish. As the health navigator was writing her assistance voucher, Emily opened up. She shared that she grew up in a little town in Venezuela. There was a lot of gang violence there. So she married young and migrated to the United States with her husband. One of them was born in Venezuela, and the other two were born in the United States. These are her children. She said that the reason she moved from Florida was because her husband was abusive. He wasn't like that at first, but he became more abusive when work became stressful and money became tighter. And then the family grew bigger. At first, he wouldn't let her work, but then he had no choice. The health navigator, Emily, kept touching her left ear and sometimes had trouble hearing. So the health navigator decided to be vulnerable and asked Emily if she had trouble hearing because they had a service that could help her with hearing aids. Emily began to cry. And she said, yes, my husband used to hit me on that side of the head a lot, and she was starting to lose her hearing on that side. The health navigator then asked her about her children and if they were enrolled in school. Emily said no, and the health navigator connected her to the team. To a team member who helped with early childhood education. The health navigator finally asked, how are you? Have you talked to anyone about what happened to you? Emily said no, but I would like to. That day, Emily came in for assistance with a tooth extraction and left with a dental voucher, an appointment with an ear doctor, an appointment to enroll her kids in school, and an appointment with a domestic violence therapist. That was because she was contacted and reached when in a holistic approach. So I live in Kansas City, Missouri. Kansas City, we have the Blue River watershed. And the Blue River watershed is a bi-state area. We have a map on the left from the Nature Conservancy and a map on the right from the EPA. The Blue Watershed has federal partnerships that help with grants and navigating assistance for different issues happening in the watershed. The upper blue watershed is more agricultural. The middle blue watershed is more urbanized, and it connects and confluences with the Missouri River. The picture that you see in the middle, this is something we see regularly along the Blue River. We have tires and we have trash that you can collect one day, the next day it'll be there. The Mississippi River Basin covers about 40% of the continental United States. 90% of the flow on the lower Mississippi comes from the Missouri, Ohio, and upper Mississippi basins, with 60% of flow at the Cairo, Illinois, coming from Ohio River Basin. Short-term drought across the basins since June has reduced flows on the upper Mississippi and exacerbated ongoing flows on the Missouri. The following is a 2024 Mississippi River Public Opinion Poll commissioned by the Hispanic Access in partnership with FM3 Radio and New Bridge Strategy. And it has, for the first time ever, captured Latino perspectives on the challenges connecting the Mississippi River. Here I'll read a few things that caught my attention. So 74% of Latinos consider pollution of rivers and lakes and streams a very extremely serious problem. And 66% of Latinos consider plastic pollution in the ocean a very extremely serious problem. This poll shows that Latinos do care about the issues happening in the river. As we heard from our other panelists here, there are various issues that lie in the river, whether it's invasive species plants, whether it's illegal dumping issues, agricultural polluters, lack of tree canopy, polluted runoff. And that can be issues that we see in neighborhoods from urban heat islands, lack of trees, which cause health issues such as respiratory issues, mental health problems. As we're looking at these issues, we have to look at the big picture. How are these environmental issues affecting the people in the places where they live? These problems aren't only happening in Kansas City, they're also happening in Missouri, in the Mississippi area, and really in all parts of the nation. And other issues that we see is also a lot of the smokestacks. Again, we mentioned pollution, even dog waste is an issue. Not picking up after your dogs is an issue because we have that runoff from heavy rains, and that eventually flows into the river. So here are some pictures. You'll see me on a lot of these pictures, and that's because I care. That's also because you see a lot of the same people, and they're people of color, and they're the ones that are constantly being reached out to. Either they're people of color, they have a disability, they have a background where they're LGBT. These are the people and the voices that they wanna hear. And they being just different assistants, funders, and these are people that care because they're the people that experience these issues and they experience them on a real level. We have Missouri Department of Conservation who's doing a lot in Kansas City. Bridging the Gap is another nonprofit organization. Black Urban Growers, Heartland Conservation Alliance. We have the Resilient Activist, which is a nonprofit that helps just people that are doing this work that get burned out so easily. And we have technical assistance services. I mentioned that I work at the Heartland Environmental Justice Center that supports individuals and organizations to navigate funds that exist out there. Right now, there's a lot of funding, and a lot of that's going towards EJ issues. Also heard about the Justice 40. And all of that is assisting to do this work on the ground. So we do this by listening and engaging and tailoring to the communities that we serve. And the support comes in a variety of ways, whether it's a light touch guidance with navigating communities to existing trainings and resource, medium touch support, such as preparation of grant applications. We can't write the grants for them, but again, think about what that means when people can't write or don't have access to technology. And then there's intensive assistance like policy analysis or technical and engineering expertise that we provide. And we do all this with program managers and community program coordinators, community engagement coordinators, and partners that can support these needs by providing resources and training. And there are challenges that we do face. There are 16 technical assistants around the nation, and they were able to ask up to $10 million for grants. And so they are also limited in the scope of services that they can provide. I mentioned they can offer grant writing, but they can't write the grants, or they have funds that disperse the needs to communities, but the communities have trouble accessing those funds because they have to apply for a unique identification number. So just these barriers that they go through. And there's also very sensitive environmental justice topics. I chose you know, a story that was very sensitive, that was very powerful, that had a lot of emotion. So think about the mental health and the whole aspect as we're thinking about the health of our rivers. There's also the health of the people and how we play a role in what we're doing on the ground. And so the key takeaways that I want you to take from this presentation is to approach watershed issues through a holistic lens, that grassroots organizations need direct funding with less stringent limitations. TICTACs need to be held accountable and supported by federal agencies such as the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency and the Department of Energy. And Latinos care about protecting our natural resources, and their voices need to be heard. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for looking out for us. We did kind of need that stretch. I feel like that was exactly the right call at that point in the program. All right, so we don't have a wireless mic today, so if we have questions in the room, you can raise your hand and speak. I'm going to repeat them into the mic. While you all are working up your courage, I'm going to ask a question, and Colin, I'm going to come back to you because it's been a little while since we've heard from you. And I'd like to sort of start, Mississippi's really big, right? It covers a lot of ground, right, the basin and everything, but it's also really long, and it goes through lots of different states, so how are you all, in your work in the Mississippi River, engaging with communities at different points along the river system and doing so in a way that doesn't create any unintended consequences for other communities at other points? How are you encouraging communities and that engagement to think of it as a whole thing and not just the little part of the river that happens to be maybe right in front of your community?
Sure. So it's a good question. It is big. It's a lot to bite off, as we have found since our inception in 2012. I would say that when you look at what does the mayor of Osceola, Arkansas, have in common with the mayor of Davenport, Iowa, or the mayor of Cape Girardeau, Missouri, with Ramsey, Minnesota? And turns out a lot. They're all managing cities. The problems are the same. The impacts are the same. The issues are the same. What's different is scale and population. True, all politics is local. That is a totally true statement. But that's more when you're dealing with the folk at home. When you're dealing with the actual problems, the mechanics of it, it's all very, very similar. You put mayors together in a room from vastly different cultural, geographic, and political circumstances, they get to work together right away. And it's a big relief because they realize they're not alone. They don't have to reinvent the wheel. Most likely the work has been done in some form or fashion somewhere else on the river. But also, and this is the most important aspect of this, the mayors of Louisiana, for instance, and this actually happened to us when we were having our annual meeting in New Orleans in 2014, Mayor Landrieu, Mitch Landrieu at the time, was hosting. And we had 30 members of the press in the room with these mayors. It was one of our early meetings, so the press was interested in how all these mayors were going to get along, to your point, Dan. And one of the members of the press asked Mitch Landrieu, why do you care what's going on in Iowa or Minnesota when we have our own problems down here? And before he could even answer, the mayor of St. Cloud, Minnesota said, Mayor, can I take that real quick? And Mitch said, sure. And go ahead. And the mayor of St. Cloud said, I'm glad you asked that. The companies that are operating at the Port of New Orleans are headquartered in my city. If we don't keep this a functioning river, I lose those jobs. If that port is not working right outside this window where we were, then I lose jobs, I lose economy in St. Cloud, Minnesota. And that is the truth up and down that river from wherever you are. Not only that, but as the mayor of Greenville, Mississippi likes to say, I cannot solve my climate issues working in my backyard. It's absolutely impossible. I have to work with Iowa, Illinois, Missouri, Minnesota, and Wisconsin. that is where the bulk of my exposure is actually coming from. If I don't work with them, then I'm not really mitigating my risk systemically. And just last point for this audience in particular, we have a Mississippi River caucus in the U.S. House and Senate. It's chaired bipartisanly, 4 House co-chairs, 2 Senate co-chairs. The Senate, it's Senator Klobuchar and Senator Bozeman of Arkansas. And without that caucus, we wouldn't have nearly been able to get what we've been able to do for the Mississippi River.
Thanks, Colin. And Sarah, in your experience, how do you work up and down the river with so many different types of communities?
Yeah, I mean, the Nature Conservancy has the benefit of, again, being in all those states and really doing work from on the ground up to the leadership public offices. But one of the things we absolutely approach the river as a system. I mean, you just heard one way it's connected. I mean, it's connected in so many ways. The agriculture runoff in the upper part of the basin is what's causing the hypoxia zone. So there's just everything is connected. Floods connected, you know, and where you do one action is definitely going to have, you know, impacts in other locations. So the planning tool that I talked about is one way that we kind of look at those trade-offs. Where are you going to make investments to solve, you know, nutrient issues or flood issues? And you can look in those kind of GIS-based planning tools using the underpinning science to say where that has, you know, trade-offs or impacts in other locations. And we're looking at what's, you know, where can we get the greatest multiple benefit? Colin talked about this. The multiple benefit net positive out of actions and investments. So it's really drawing on the science that we have and tools and planning and collaborative planning too, because it's got to have, you know, that's got to be driven at the community level, the actions and investments as well.
Amanda, over to you. I'm curious what you have to say.
Yeah, at NWF, we, you know, when we started working on our Mississippi River program, which is a relatively new program for us, but we've been working on the river for a very long time. So we actually did something kind of unique just at the organizational level, in that we have leadership, like a small steering team that's, you know, working on ag, working on the Delta, working on natural infrastructure, and we all work together. The first thing that we did when we started to stand up the concept of the program was reach out to our affiliates, which are in every one of the main STEM states, and bring them in. And we also work in a lot of partnerships. So we work in coalition with a lot of other NGOs like TNC that are doing a lot of work, so that we know that everything, you know, that we're leveraging the work and that we're making sure that we're being most effective with our resources and our capacity and what we bring to the table. We're working in communities all up and down the river, and just making sure that we stay really coordinated and in each of the regions that we're working along the river. You know, we make sure that we're working with the right community partners and community leadership, local government, and then also all the way up to the federal agency level, and just a lot of communication. Thinking about the projects and the work that we're doing, even if it's smaller scale, and making sure that has, you know, looking at scalability, looking at transferability of these different projects that we're working on, restoration, resilience projects. So I think those are some of the ways that we're just, as an organization, really prioritizing that whole river comprehensive look and making sure that it's a big area. So the Mississippi River is really unique because from the headwaters to the Delta, you hit so many, you know, different geographies and landscapes and issues. So it really, you have to be very intentional with that comprehensive approach. So you're working on that.
And I'm stepping back because I'm a better door than a window. And I want Colin and Sarah to be able to see the three of you and vice versa. Katie, Sarah mentioned hypoxia, maybe a classic example of this. How do you talk to communities differently, maybe where the sources of, you know, the chemicals that eventually contribute to hypoxia versus, you know, the communities, the part of the river that maybe suffer from it the most?
Yeah. I think that the way the hypoxia task force is organized, with the states being, you know, the implementer of their own nutrient reduction strategies, That is the perfect place for all those local communities to first engage on these issues. Go to your state, folks. Learn from them. They offer public meetings. They offer a lot of different engagement opportunities in that work. They know the issues that you're managing within your states and that you're dealing with. Stepping up a level, we also engage with the sub-basin committees. So we have three sub-basin committees represented by Orsenco on the Ohio, by the Upper Mississippi River Basin Association on the upper portion of the Mississippi River, and by a new Lower Mississippi River Consortium of states. Those are kind of that regional framework of engagement. There are state members of those associations who can engage on, you know, cross-boundary issues that are similar in those areas. And then we also work with a land-grant consortium. 12 land-grant universities have two representatives each on SARA 46, a group that helps communicate the challenges of the science from the voices of those state land-grant universities to the people within the states, but also to educate the state and federal folks engaged in this. So really, the state level, that regional scale, and then the federal agency support for that. But we, you know, we are as good as we can be as the local folks can do the work. A lot of our programs are supporting that local, those local efforts. There's a lot of grassroots efforts that are formed through the support through this very big network of governments working together.
And Magali, the state you mentioned, four states: Iowa, Kansas, Missouri, Nebraska, plus all the tribal areas. So how do you work with communities in different parts of the, you know, up and down the Mississippi, and how do you work to try to get them sort of all, I guess, swimming in the same direction or rowing in the same direction or what other river metaphor?
So that takes communication within the own team, because I'm working on the Kansas City side. So that does cover the Kansas City, Kansas, and the Blue River. And I mentioned the Blue River being a bi-state area. So it takes communication. It takes assessment of what exists there, what are the benefits that we can already use, and what are the communities facing, whether it's in different environmental issues in their area. A big focus that I mentioned is the energy issue. So how do we talk to folks about transitioning to other jobs, because they work in jobs that you know, do take up more energy and burn other resources and fuels. So it's really making an assessment first of what exists there, using tools like the CJUS tool from the EPA, and seeing what kind of pollutants already exist, and making sure that we're also connecting them to local partners, whether they're on the state level too. I mentioned the Missouri Department of Conservation. There's also the Missouri Department of Natural Resources. So connecting those organizations that are set up and are trying to build capacity, I think that's a big issue that we hear a lot, building capacity. And building capacity can look different. What we see building capacity is just needing someone to administrate funds, or someone that can be the program manager that has the knowledge to do certain things. So sharing information is a big thing. And like Amanda mentioned, communication.
Thanks. We have time for one question in the audience. I'm going to ask you to say the question, and I'll just repeat it, just so that the people in our live cast, I'm not. All right, so to recap your question, I'll try to go back. Okay. There was an Energy and Commerce hearing. EPA Inspector General talked about how the agency is struggling, his words, administering IIJA and IRA resources. And then you specifically focused that question to Katie to ask about if the Hypoxia Task Force is experiencing similar issues. And then broader, if the other panelists would like a chance to answer, how do we talk about these federal investments in a way that resonates with constituents who might not be, you know, always convinced about the bang for the buck, right? Okay, good.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I'll say from where I sit, we're administering a $60 million over 5-year program. I mentioned that the task force has been in existence since the late 90s. These folks know what they needed to do. The states were ready to apply for those funds and to put the 115 or so projects that I mentioned in place. And that is all rolled out within the last 2 years. So we've got the 12 state grants. We're beginning to roll out a second round of 12 more state grants. There's 15 grants to tribes. 7 of those tribes are coming in for treatment as state for Clean Water Act programs, which is a pretty significant opportunity for those tribes. They were ready to do that. The land-grant universities and the 3 sub-basin committees are coordinating a lot of cross-state boundary communications and education opportunities. So maybe it's because the task force has been around for so long, we've been talking about these issues, but we were ready. Those grant recipients were ready to go with their projects.
Thanks. Magali, Amanda, Sarah, Colin, responses to the other part of the question. Magali, if you'd like to go first.
Yeah, I would. Thank you. So you mentioned tracking this information and, you know, sharing it back with the public, correct? And that is an issue that we face very commonly. How do we track all this information? How do we do it in a consistent way so that we can tell a story? What I attempted to do when I came on the stage was provide you with stories that have meaning, stories that you may not be able to digest in the moment and say, what does this make me feel? What does this make me relate to? And so stories are a very powerful tool to be able to get that messaging across when you have to dissect all that data, even if you do have it, because there is a lot of raw data that we just haven't been able to even put in the system to be able to tell that story. So yes, it's all a matter of what you do with the data and how, what kind of systems that you're using to be able to track that information.
Amanda? You were talking about accountability for how the funds are being used by taxpayers, and I agree. The first thing that came to mind was communicating about how the funds are being used and the solutions, and I think a lot of times that doesn't happen as well as it should, and telling that story of why these investments are helpful. And and I think one of the takeaways from that network mapping I talked about earlier, that I didn't get to go over specifically, was about you know, making the case for these investments, and there is a strong case to be made for these investments, and those of us that work in that know that, but we need to communicate that to the public. So that's an opportunity for us with the IIJA and EIL funding, important opportunity for us to shift that public perspective on natural infrastructure investment.
Sarah, do you have any thoughts?
Yeah, I'll just add quickly. We're focused a lot on telling the IIJA, IRA investment stories and really trying to bring them to real people whose lives have been positively benefited from those investments. So if you go on our site, nature.org, I think it's /policy, there's a whole section there telling little stories that we've collected. And you know, because of the increase in funding from those investments collectively, I will say we are starting to see investments at a scale that's really having benefit on a system like the Mississippi River. So, you know, we're going to be advocating for certain programs to get continued robust funding because we're really seeing those benefits now starting to hit the ground.
Colin, you'll get the last word today. You can respond to the question, but it's not like I can do anything. You can talk about whatever you want for a few seconds.
History of the waffle iron, okay. Yeah. So that's a good question. We've gotten two grants, an IRA grant and a Jobs Act grant. The Jobs Act grant was for DOT Protect program to build a forest right outside of Memphis, Tennessee, in West Memphis, Arkansas, to protect West Memphis and Memphis. The IRA grant that we got was for Davenport, Bettendorf, and Riverdale, Iowa, to renature the Duck Creek River because it was a major disaster zone. And our mayors decided if we renature that tributary of the Mississippi River, which is an urban tributary, we can reduce those disasters and prop up the outdoor recreation and tourism economy of all three cities. Two major challenges: technical assistance, authorized expenses. These two major challenges plague both the IRA as a vehicle and the Jobs Act as a vehicle. The communities that both of those vehicles was to prioritize for can't even apply. They don't have the resources to apply, and if there's a match, forget about it. Rosedale, Mississippi is never going to be able to apply for one of these grants. The IRA grant that we got was for with NRCS. The Memphis, West Memphis grant that we got was with DOT. EPA is nowhere in the mix. Because on the authorized expense side, EPA has a real difficult time awarding projects that benefit and implicate multiple states at one time. An extremely difficult time. That's one. And two, most of the natural infrastructure money out of both vehicles went to the Corps. Most of what the Corps ended up spending on was the Everglades. What's left went to a program called NESP. And NESP is habitat restoration projects that were outlined in the 1990s. So we need more flexibility in how we can authorize spending toward multiple state natural infrastructure projects that mitigate for climate impact at scale. Also, localities and states need to be authorized to spend IRA and Jobs Act money on intense heat and drought. Those are the two major impacts that we don't have national policy over, and we desperately need national drought policy. Besides named storm events, it is the most expensive climate impact our country is facing, and we have no policy for it. We have lots of risk mitigation, risk management, but we have no policy. Same with intense heat. And finally, EPA needs to push out funds. They can do this. They have the authority from Congress to push out funds to groups like the groups at this table that are non-federal, of course, and other groups to push out technical assistance. Pay third-party organizations to offer technical assistance on the ground to communities that would never, ever be able to apply and still haven't to this day.
Well, we have to close it there. We're several minutes over. Sorry about that, but I think it was great. Thank you so much. I think our panelists deserve a round of applause. It's a good way to start our river briefing series. Thanks to our panelists for doing a great job. Thanks to Senator Baldwin. I don't see Patrick anymore. He was lurking earlier, but he's a good egg in Senator Baldwin's office. So thanks to that team for help with the room. I'd like to say thanks to my EESI colleagues. Anna, I see you first, so I'll say Anna, but as well as Dan O, Omri, Allison, Molly, and Nicole. We also have three awesome interns right now: Jemiah, who is our timekeeper, Josh, who got out of microphone duty, and Alia, who is helping us with communications and photos and things like that today. So thanks a lot. Scott, our videographer, thank you very much as well. This was great. Maybe we have a few minutes to hang out afterwards. I know some people have some flights to catch. I'd also like to thank the person in the audience who shouted out Ranger Rick. I didn't put that together, but now I know. And I'm sorry for accusing the raccoon of just taking that Ranger's hat. Not that sorry. Anyway, next up, we have some briefings coming up, October 23rd, 24th, and 25th. It is Coptober at EESI. We're going to have extensive coverage of the UN climate negotiations. We have three briefings, one about U.S.-China relations, one about the global methane pledge, and one about the negotiations themselves. They're going to be a great briefing series. They're all they're three consecutive days, hour-long briefings, amazing panelists. It's a great way to get up to speed before the climate negotiations start, so you'll be able to answer all of your boss's hard questions. We also have a daily newsletter that comes out every day during COP called COP Dispatch. You can go to www.esi.org/subscribe to subscribe to that, as well as to Climate Change Solutions. And you have about an hour and a half, hour and 20 minutes before Climate Change Solutions comes out today. Lastly, this is just the link again to the survey. If you have a moment to take the survey, that would be great. We read every response. If you had, and you're in our livecast audience, for example, and you had problems with audio or visuals or anything like that, please just let us know. We'll wrap there. Thanks again to everybody. This was a great kickoff for our briefing series, and really appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.